Take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Deuteronomy. The book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 1. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate your faithfulness. I appreciate you taking the time to come to the house of God. I love this church. I love this church with all of my heart. I really do. And it's not the building that I love. It's you that I love. It's the people. The Twin City Baptist Church is who I love. And my desire as a pastor is to help you. My desire is for you to leave here with something from God. And I long for that. I was pleading with the Lord last night, "Oh God, let me be you. Let me be you. Let me not stand there by myself." And as I'm going through particular books, I'm going through this particular book, the book of Deuteronomy. And I'm going to start in chapter 1, verse number 21. We'll skip around, but I just want to read a couple verses out of this chapter and summarize it for you. It's a long chapter, so I don't want to bore you with my reading, but I do want to see what the Scripture said. The Bible says in Deuteronomy 1, if you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And thank you for bringing your Bible. You know, I know we live in a day of iPads and iPods and I this and I that, and I've got them and I use them, but I just love a Bible. I just love a book. You know, I just like holding that. Sometimes people think I'm foolish, but I just like it. You know, I just like holding the Bible and opening it up and looking into it. So let's look at it, see what the Bible says. In verse number 21, the Bible says, "Behold, the Lord thy God hath set the land before thee. Go up and possess it. As the Lord God of thy fathers has said unto thee, fear not, neither be discouraged." Jump down with me to verse 26. "Notwithstanding, you would not go up, but rebelled against the commandment of the Lord your God. And you murmured in your tents and said, because the Lord hated us, he hath brought us forth out of the land of Egypt to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites to destroy us." Verse 28. "Whether shall you go up? Our brethren have discouraged our heart, saying, the people is greater and taller than we. The cities are great and walled up to the heaven. And moreover, we have seen the sons of Anakims there. Then I said unto you, dread not, neither be afraid of them. The Lord your God, which goeth before you, shall fight for you according to all that he did for you in Egypt before your eyes." We'll go on and on, but look at those two expressions in verse number 21. "Neither be discouraged." In verse number 28, "Our brethren have discouraged our heart." I want to preach a message to you this morning. A discouraged heart. A discouraged heart. We find out in this particular book of the Bible, the book of Deuteronomy is a book of the second law. Moses is being taken the children of Israel in to the land of Canaan. God promised them that they would go into this land. God promised that they would go into this particular land years and years and years before they got to this place. They got here and now they're standing on the threshold of going into the land of Canaan. And God tells them, he said, okay, now that you're going in, you're going to conquer this and conquer that and achieve this and get a hold of this land. He said, I want you to go in, but I want you to go in with a civil law. I want you to go in with some rules and some guidelines. Well, the book of Deuteronomy is just that. The book of Deuteronomy is its guidelines, its civil law, its rules and do's and don'ts of what God did not want them to do or what he did want them to do. And it's fascinating to me that when I read chapter 1 of Deuteronomy, before they go into the great promised land, that's all they'd ever heard of their childhood days, of generations past. God's going to give us a land. God's going to give us a land. God's going to give us a land. That's all they'd ever heard. And on the brink of it, on the threshold of this great and mighty day, they're discouraged. This great day that they're going to walk into the Canaan land and they're going to find a vineyard that they didn't plant. They're going to find olive yards that they didn't plant. They're going to find houses that they didn't build. They're going to find all these wonderful things. Just imagine, if you will, just for a moment, you're walking into this magnificent land, this magnificent city that you didn't build. I think about America. When I walk to the shores of America, when I walk the beaches and I walk the cities and I walk the great places of the United States of America, America, I stand in awe because I was given a country that I didn't pay for. I was given a country, I'm free to go to and fro this land. I travel the roads quite a bit, and I never have to ask anybody, can I travel that road? Because men and women bled and died for me and gave me that great freedom that I can walk around and do as I please. And here, these people are walking into this land of Canaan land. They're walking into a place, and God says to them, now I want you to walk in, and it's yours, and I promised it to you. But look, I don't want you to get to forgetful. I don't want you to get to the place where you're discouraged. And the very first thing we find happening to them is they're discouraged. You know, it's interesting to me. I don't think it's sinful to get discouraged, but I do think it's sinful to stay discouraged. If you and I get to the place where we're discouraged all the time, we need to check up. If you and I live in a discouraged type mode, we need to do some soul searching. If you and I, and by the way, we're all flesh and blood, there's going to be times, look, your life's going to throw you sucker punches. Your life's going to throw you circumstances that you had no control over. Your life's going to give you a bill of goods that you didn't buy. But just let it known today that just because life is not fair and life throws you sucker punches and life brings things to you that you didn't ask for, I want you to know, don't let that discourage you to the place where it destroys you. Because discouragement will destroy your life. And no doubt about it, we find here that they're just about to go into the greatest thing they've ever had. And I think it's interesting that the devil always likes to throw the greatest temptations at you at the beginning of something. You ever notice that? If you start out to do something for God, I think about soul winning on Saturday. You know, Saturday I had 1,000 things I could go do. But I thought, no, I've done decided to do this. I've done nailed it down. I'm going to do this. And the devil was trying to discourage me. He was trying to do everything he could do, put in my path, because I had set out to do something for God. I'm here to tell you, if you set out to do something for God, if you decide, look, I make a vow, I make a plan, I make a goal, just nail it down, you're going to get discouraged over it. Because the devil's going to throw something in your way, the devil's going to throw something in your path, and he's going to mess up, the tire's going to go flat on the car won't start, or the garage door won't go up. I mean, there's going to be all kinds of things that's going to discourage you from doing what God's called you to do. Here, the children of Israel had a discouraged heart. Notice what they said in verse 21. Something that I find fascinating, verse 21, the Bible says, behold, the Lord thy God. They got discouraged at God. Now, I know we don't say that audibly. I know we don't boast about being discouraged at God. But I can't help but think, and I'll be honest with you, there's been times in my life, in recent times, I'd get discouraged and I blame God. Can I tell you, that's sinful. That's not Bible Christianity, because what we do here, they did the same thing. If you'll know the children of Israel, notice what he said in verse 21. Behold, the Lord thy God has set the land before thee. Go up and possess it as the Lord God of thy fathers has said unto thee. Fear not. God put them there. They were discouraged. He said, why are you discouraged? I brought you to a place that I promised you. Why are you discouraged? You shouldn't be discouraged. You shouldn't live in a discouraging type way. He said they're discouraged. Notice what he says in verse 22. And you came near unto me. Everyone, the greatest discouraging, the way to defeat discouragement is to get near God. If you want to get discouraged and stay discouraged, just stay away from God. I'm telling you something, if you get near the cross, if you get near the Lord Jesus Christ, if you get near His mercy and His grace and that blood flowing from His brow and that side beaten from Him and that precious body being beaten for you, you know what? You can't stay discouraged long. When you look at the mercy of God and the grace of God and the salvation that He's bestowed upon you, how in the world could we get discouraged? But we do. Things don't happen the way we want. The circumstances doesn't take place like we like. And if we're not careful, we'll get discouraged at God. I see they got discouraged at God in verse 21. And in verse 28, they got discouraged because of the brethren. That's a sad thing. Notice what he said in verse 28. Whether thou go up, our heart saying, our brethren hath discouraged our heart. How many times have you got discouraged because of somebody? Sure you have. You've got discouraged because of your wife. You've got discouraged because of your husband. You got discouraged because of your pastor, maybe. There's no doubt there's times, and the truth is, people will let you down. You cannot put your stock in people. You cannot put your trust in people. The Bible says put confidence in no man. Now, there's no doubt we love people, and we encourage people, and we try to do all we can for people. But when you put your trust and your confidence in a person and expect that person to meet your every need, you're going to find a failure. You're going to find somebody that's disappointing to you. You're going to find somebody that's discouraging you. Here, notice what they did. They looked to their brethren, and the brethren would not encourage them because of this. Notice what it says. The people is greater and taller than we. Y'all, you can't do that. You can't accomplish that for God. And the truth is, you hear something long enough and loud enough, you'll believe it. That's what Hitler said. Hitler said, you believe, if you say something long enough and loud enough, they'll believe it. I can't help but think about these precious young people that's in these public schools and the places that we get to minister to. And my wife's in the school as a nurse, and she sees more of it than me. But she comes home, tells me stories that just rocks my world when I think of how in the world can a young girl take two kids to the daycare, get on a school bus, and go to school. It's unbelievable. And all they ever hear from their parents or their grandparents or foster or whoever they're living with, you're no good. You're at a zero. You're never going to make anything. And you're just a bunch of mistakes. And on it goes. I mean, you hear that stuff long enough and you hear that stuff loud enough, you get to the place where people are just discouraging to you. That's what they had here, the book of Deuteronomy, that second law, that going into the promised land. They were so fearful to go into that land. Notice what he says. We can't go into that land. What? What do you mean you can't go in it? This is the land. Might I remind you, this is the land that God gave you. God gave you this land. And you're going to stand on the threshold and listen to somebody ridicule or say something negative and discourage you from going into the greatest thing God has ever given to you? Don't let circumstances discourage you. Don't let people discourage you. Notice what he says in verse 28. The wall is tall. The city's tall. He said it goes up to heaven. Now be honest, did it really go up to heaven? No. But they looked around and said, whoo, we can't do this. Remember what, when they went in and spied the land, only Joshua and Caleb was the only two that came back that was positive. The other spies were negative. If you'll notice, God took note of that because in verse 36, the only two people that were going into the Canaan land was in verse 36. Notice this, save Caleb. And then the other one, notice what he says, the son of Zephaniah, and he shall see it, and to him I will give the land that he hath trodden upon and his children because he hath wholly followed the Lord. You know what he said? He said all those murmurers and all those discouragers and all those people that said negative things, I'm not going to let them go in. The only people I'm going to go let go in are those ones that encouraged. You know what I want Twin City Baptist Church to be? You know what I want this particular local New Testament church to be? To be known as a people that encourages. People that look on other people's circumstances and other people's lives and get involved and say to them, I'm not going to discourage that individual. I'm not going to push that individual down. I'm going to encourage that someone. I'm going to strengthen that someone. Look, the church, if the church is not going to be the encourager, this world sure is not going to be. Look, this world's got enough trouble. There's enough heartache and difficulty and pain in the world. The church, if the church doesn't rise up and be that encouraging heart to the one that needs it, who's going to be? There's not going to be one. I wrote this quote down. Discouragement often comes the morning before something the Lord's doing great. I found that so true. Discouragement, it seems, always on the threshold of God doing something great. It's almost like I'm discouraged. I just can't take another step. I'm so discouraged and I'm so disheartened. I'm just so low. But if you'll just take another step, God will meet you and open up doors that will blow your mind. I promise you, if you'll just take another step, if you'll just walk another mile, God will meet you there. You may be discouraged. You may have a discouraged heart today. And I trust God gave me this message. If you're here today with a discouraged heart, we're going to see some ways to identify it. Before you can fix discouragement, you've got to find it. I'd like to know, just as statistics, how many people walk around regularly with a discouraged heart. It would blow my mind. It would blow your mind. We put on a smile on Sunday. We put our suit on and our ties and our nice dresses and our shoes. We shine our shoes. We comb our hair and we walk into the church house. But I can't help but think on the inside of our bosom is a discouraged heart. I heard a joke about a little boy. His mama, he walked into the kitchen. She said, "Sit down, we're going to eat supper." And he was standing up. She just shoved him down. And he stood back to his feet. She said, "I said sit down." And he sat down and he stood back to his feet. And she said, "I said sit down." And she set him down. And she said, "I said sit there." He said, "I may be sitting down on the outside, but I'm standing up on the inside." Can I tell you that's exactly what happens to Christians? We get discouraged and no one knows it. Can I hear to tell you? If you walk around with a discouraged heart very long, it will destroy you. I promise you. I promise you, according to the Word of God, do you know whatever is on the inside and you harbor that and you hold that and you don't express that to God and you don't give that discouragement to Him and ask Him to take it away and renew you and strengthen you, it will eat you from the inside. These dear people that I'm preaching to you today was not going to walk in to the greatest thing they had ever heard because of one little word, discouragement. They said, "God's discouraged us because He brought us to a place we didn't really want to be at. Here we're standing at this threshold. We don't really want to be there." Notice what happens. I want to give you three ways to identify discouragement. If you're here today with discouragement, I'm going to give you three ways to identify it. And then we're going to give you three ways to fix it. But three ways to identify discouragement. Notice the first one in verse 26. "Notwithstanding, you would not go up, but rebelled." Notice that word, rebelled. You ought to write that down somewhere. One of the ways to identify discouragement is rebellion. I have never met an individual that's discouraged that had not been filled with some type of rebellion. Notice what he said. He said, "Notwithstanding that you would not go up, but rebelled against the commandment of the Lord your God." Why were they discouraged with God? They were discouraged with God because they did not listen to Him and would not go with when He said go and would not stop when He said go stop. And they just did defiance all the time. Discouragement is often fueled. Listen to me now. Discouragement is often fueled by rebellion. There again, it's not sinful to get discouraged, but it is sinful to stay discouraged. Because discouragement is fueled by rebellion. It was here. You say, "I'm not rebellious." If you said that in your heart, you're rebellious. If you just said to me, "Preacher, you're not going to tell me I'm rebellious," you're rebellious. He said here, he said, "You know why you're discouraged? You know why you're down and out? Because the Bible says you rebelled against the commandment of the Lord." You know what the Bible says in 1 Samuel? He said, "Rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft." We talk about, listen to me now, we talk about kids and teenagers becoming rebellious. And we point our fingers at young people and we point our fingers at our youth that are raising up to be rebellious. But where do you think they learned that? You can say all day long that your young person, your teenager is rebellion and your children don't listen and they won't do this. But what about you and God? You know, my brother said to me one time, he said, "You know, our children are tape recorders and video cameras." Where did they learn that rebellion? No doubt it's bound up in the heart of a child. We understand that. But I can't help but think a lot of rebellion is seen by their parents. Here's a generation a whole entire generation of rebellious people. And if you search the scripture and go back in the book of Numbers and go back to the book of Exodus and you go back and you see the generations that taught the generation I'm preaching to you this morning, if you see that generation, their generation was made up of nothing but murmurings and complaining and fussing about Moses and fussing about Aaron and I don't like this and I don't like this and why has God brought us here and why has God brought us there? Those little hearers were going, why did God bring us here? Now this generation is an adult now and they stand on the threshold and guess what? I ain't going in there. Where did they learn that? They learned that from mama and daddy. They learned that. Notice what he says in verse 27. Rebellion. None didn't know what he said in verse 27. He said, and you murmured in your tents. Whew. He murmured in your tents when mama and daddy chew up the others in the tent. The little ears are listening. When you're chewing up the neighbor, when you're chewing up the preacher, when you're chewing up the church, and when you're murmuring, complaining against God, you know who's hearing that? Those little ears. You don't live unto yourself and you don't die unto yourself. You are developing a discouraged individual when you murmur and complain and rebel against God. You murmured in your tents. That expression, that tent is where they live, by the way. That tent there in verse 27 is in the privacy of their own home. Sometimes we get the idea, well, if I get in the car or if I get in the house and shut the door, nobody will hear me. Oh, they're hearing you. They're listening. I see rebellion. I see murmuring. Notice what it says, because the Lord hated us and he brought us forth out of the land of Egypt to deliver us in the hand of the Amorites. They heard their mamas and their daddies and their pawpaws and their mamas saying, oh, God's going to kill us. God's going to kill us. I can't believe God brought us here. Them little ears are going, I see murmuring. You know what that word murmuring gives us the idea of? Backbiting. You know why most teenagers grow up to backbite or to rebel? It's because they saw it in person. Let me read Colossians chapter 4. You don't have to turn over there. I'll just read it to you. Colossians chapter 4 in verse number 6. Here's what the Bible says about our speech. Let your speech be alway with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. Can I tell you, there is a huge, huge component to our Christianity, and it's the word words. There's so much weight in words. Here, discouragement was fueled by rebellion, and rebellion was fueled by murmuring. And the last one I see, the threes, is the verse 27, I see a refuse to believe. Notice what he said. He said, they murmured in your tents. Here it is, because the Lord hated us and he brought us out of the land of Egypt. They refused to believe that God was going to bring them into the land of Canaan. They heard their mamas and their daddies say, God can't do that. God can't do this. God can't do this. God can't do that. They heard that, and there's a generation that grew up not to believe God. Do you know in 2017, they say almost 80% of those young people are not darkening the door of the church? We're losing a group of young people. We're losing a group of young people as statistically is because they do not know and have not been taught why and what is the reason we're doing the things we do. They ask questions like this: why do we go to church? Why do we read the Bible? Why do we pray? Why do we do some of the things we do? And they're left, and I heard a statistic just the other day from my own verbal person. They said this. They said, they won't tell me why we're doing what we're doing. There's a generation that does not know God. It's because there's a generation that is not teaching them what God expects. And there's a generation not going in to the land of Canaan because they got a discouraged heart. Three ways to identify it. Notice this one. Three ways to defeat it. I don't know about you, but I'm looking to defeat discouragement. I'm not looking to let it to beat me. We was talking the other day about cancer. It's unbelievable. Brother Bostic died. His cancer came back in his pancreas and his colon, and aggressive. He came back so aggressive, they said, that's what took his life. Cancer is a household name now, it seems. Cancer is something that 4 or 5 days a week I hear something about cancer. And I said something to somebody the other day, I said, I guess it's just a matter of time. You better pack our bags, I guess, because we're all about to get it. We identify cancer, and they know where it comes from, and they are researching, and on it goes. But I can't help but think of how many people have fallen out of God's work because of discouragement. We identified it. We've seen out of the Scripture that they rebelled, they murmured. They let circumstances dictate to them, and they refused to believe God. But here's 3 ways to defeat it. Notice verse 29. Then said I unto you, here is Moses, and he's come back, and he's combating them. And he says, look, I said unto you, dread not, neither be afraid. Can I tell you that God never gave us fear? God didn't give you fear. Anytime you fear, that is not of God. I don't care when it is. The other day, last night, Levi, I think this is funny. Last night we saw Cece Fultz, and she was in the Walmart parking lot. And we were walking in late last night, and we walked in, and I saw her standing there. She's been sick, by the way. She broke her ankle, and she's been out. I caught her out. She said, oh, preacher, don't tell nobody I'm here. So it's on. She knows I'm telling it now. But I saw her and Isaac, and they didn't see me, so I ran up to the window, and I stuck my face in the window like this. And when she turned around, she went, ah! She said, you scared me. There's one thing to be scared. That's of the flesh. But if you fear, that's of the devil. God said in the book of 1 Timothy, that God, 2 Timothy, for God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. So just mark it down. If you're ever in fear, that's not of God. You say, I fear this. I fear what the future holds. I fear this job. I fear this. Let me tell you something. That is not of God. God did not give us a spirit of fear. The way to defeat discouragement is to realize that God gave us the victory. I'm not going to fear. You know, some fear failure. Some fear the past. Some fear the present. There's always a fear around us. That is not of God. Here the people feared because they looked at a wall. They looked at a city. It's bigger than us. It's greater than us. And there's no way I can get around it. So we're all dead. You know, there's so much to say about our mind. I read a story last night about a man that died in a boxcar, a railroad car, out of hypothermia. He died. He froze to death. And they did the autopsy, and they confirmed that his body was froze to death. They did an analysis of the car box, and they said it never got below 61 degrees. You tell me how he froze to death. He froze to death in his mind. He had a phobia. He had a phobia. He was known to have a phobia of cold, being cold. And he got locked in that box car, that railroad car, And he had scratched on the wall of that railroad car before he died, freezing. Freezing. And he died. It never got below 61 degrees. His mind convinced him that he was freezing to death. And the autopsy revealed that his body went to hypothermia and he froze to death. I'm just simply saying to you this morning that if you're living in a discouraging type mode, it's fueled by fear a lot of times, and God didn't give you that fear. Don't be afraid, verse 29. That's how to defeat it. Here's another one. Notice this one. I love verse 30. For the Lord your God, which goeth before you, I love this, shall fight for you. Look, you're on God's side. Don't be discouraged. What in the world? What in the world? Please tell me, what in the world do you and I who live in this nation, sitting in this church, what in the world do we have to be afraid of? Really? You say, well, there's enemies. Yes. But who? Bible says, don't fear the one that kills the body. Fear the one that kills the body and the soul. Look, they take this body, they can shoot a bullet through it, but that doesn't change my eternal destiny. Here, he said, don't be afraid. God will fight for you. I love that expression. He'll fight for you. You're on God's side. Notice what he said. He shall fight for you according to all that he did for you in Egypt. You know what he said? He said, if you don't believe I'll fight for you, just remember what I brought you from. If you don't believe I'm going to fight for you, if you don't believe I'm on your side, if you don't believe that you're going to win with me, just go back here when you remember when everything was blight, before you knew me, before you knew Christ, and you trusted me as your Savior. Remember that. Then you'll remember, God's going to win this thing. He said, I'll fight for you. It's interesting, in verse 31, they're standing in the wilderness. And in the wilderness, verse 31, where thou hast seen how the Lord thy God bare thee, as a man doth bear his son, in all the way that ye went, until ye came into this place. Do you see that? Do you see how they're so discouraged? They've let circumstances discourage them. They're walking around with a discouraged heart. And God said, don't be afraid. I'm going to fight for you. You're on my side. And you're standing in the very promise that I gave you decades ago. You're standing there. It'd be like saying, God, give me a new house. And you get discouraged standing in the living room. That's exactly what it's like. God gave them everything He promised, and they're standing in the wilderness looking into the promised land going, I can't believe God brought me here. God said, have you forgotten? Have you forgotten? Why are you here? Have you forgotten that I brought you here? Can I tell you, when life throws you sucker punches and when life throws you something that you didn't ask for, can I say to you, put your back straight, look in the face of God and say, you promised you'd be with me. And he'd say, amen. God's going to fight for you. I love that scripture when it says, the battle is the Lord's. It's not yours, it's the Lord's. God will fight for you. Remember all that God has done for you. Discouragement will keep you out of the will of God. This book, right at the very first chapter, when I started studying this book, I didn't get but just 20 verses into this chapter, and God just landed me right here. And I thought, good night. They even got into the promised land, and there's chapter 2, chapter 3. I mean, they're still getting everything worked out. It's not until chapter 5 or chapter 6 when they even in the promised land. Before they get in the land, they're discouraged. I mean, before this thing gets started, they're discouraged. When they should be the most encouraged, when they should be the most strengthened, but yet they're discouraged. They've allowed discouragement to hinder them. Three ways to defeat discouragement is, don't be afraid. God will fight for you. And look at verse 32. Choose to believe God. Verse 32, the Bible says, yet in this thing ye did not believe the Lord your God, who went in the way before you to search you out a place to pitch your tents in fire by night, to show you by which way you should go, and a cloud by day. And the Lord heard the voice of your words and was wroth and sware, saying, surely there shall not be one of these men of this evil generation see that good land which I swear to give unto your fathers. God looked down and He heard their murmuring, heard their complaining. He had brought them all along the way. He brought them exactly where He told them He'd bring them. He brought them to the very place He told them He'd bring them. He brought them right to the very place, and they murmured and complained. God said, that makes me angry. He said, not a one of you is going to go in except the two were positive. You're thinking. I believe as Abraham Lincoln said, he just has realized that most people are as happy as they choose to be. See, you can walk around discouraged all you want to. You have the free will and choice to be discouraged. You can stay discouraged as long as you want to. You and myself have to make the choice to believe God, trust God, and I am no longer going to be discouraged. Now, this is not a self-help, pull up yourself by the bootstraps. That's not what I'm saying. But I am saying, when you find your strength in God, and put your faith and trust in God and say, God said that this is what He's going to do, and God brought me here, and God has done this. I'm going to trust Him. God will give you the strength to do it. Choose to believe God. God said He looked down and He saw a group of people that refused to believe God. Proverbs 23:7, the Bible says, for he as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. If you think you're destroyed, you'll be destroyed. If you think you're a victory, you'll be a victory in Christ. It has a lot to do with your mind. Isaiah 26:3, the Bible says, if thou wilt be, that thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. How do you keep your mind stayed on Him with this book? I have not found one individual who's kept his mind in this book who's ever been discouraged for very long. No doubt they have valleys. No doubt they have disappointments. No doubt they don't have a bad day. No doubt that's normal. You're going to have days of discouragement. You're going to have disappointments. But look, if that's your life, you're out of the will of God. If you're living your life day after day, discouragement after discouragement, and days of disappointment, and days of down, and days of discouragement, and every day's down, and every day's down. You ever been around somebody that just everything's down? Everything's negative. Everything's bad. Oh, the world's coming in. Oh, my tail's falling off, Eeyore said. I mean, everything's just bad. Just bad all the time. Who wants to be around that? I can't help but think God don't want to be around it. He didn't want to be around them. He said, you bunch of, I call it pooch mouth. You ever get the pooch mouth? Don't talk. You ever been around somebody who won't talk to you, got the pooch mouth. I tell my kids, I said, if I upset them, whatever, I said, you can get glad, same pants you got mad in as far as I'm concerned. I'm not trying to be ugly, I'm just saying, look, it's your choice. It's my choice to be discouraged. God has given us the victory. We have no excuse to be discouraged. We have been given heaven. Our sins have been forgiven. Jesus Christ has bled and died on the cross for our sins. He's allowed us to enter into that glory land someday, and we're going to be discouraged? What a sin against God. We have no earthly right. We have no biblical right to stay discouraged. Oh, don't let God discourage you, and don't let the brethren discourage you. Don't be afraid. God will fight for you, and just choose to believe Him. It's a choice. You know, the Bible says repent. Repent. You know what repentance is? Let me demonstrate repentance. I'm about to repent. Watch this. I just repented. I was going that way and just decided to go this way. I just repented. Can I tell you, if you're here today and you're just discouraged, just turn around and go back this way. It's a choice. It's a choice. You choose. Don't blame God. Don't blame your neighbor. Don't blame your wife. Don't blame your children. If you are discouraged today, then it's your place to get it right. No one else's. Well, they've done this to me. They've done that to me. That's what the children of Israel did to God. You brought us here, God. You brought us to this place, and I can't believe we're going to die here. They blame God for it. God said, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll kill all of you. All but two of you. Discouragement. Listen to me now. Listen to me. Go home with this. Discouragement is your choice. Is your choice. Father, we bow our heads.